είναι γενικός διευθυντής του ΣΕΡ, όλοι ξέρετε στη Γενέβη. Θα ξεκινήσει με ένα χαιρετισμό ο αναπληρωτής περίτατης, ο κύριος Δημήτρης Παπαντώνης, ο οποίος προσκαλώ στον...
ο Σμήτρος της Συλλογής της ΕΦΕ.
για να δίνει ένα χαιρετισμό επίσης. Κύριε Φαράκο, ευχαριστώ.
Αξιότιμη κύριε Πίτερ, διάδοχος Υπουργείου, αγαπητοί συνάδελφοι και κύριοι φοιτητές. Είναι μεγάλη τιμή να καλωσορίζω στο Πολυτεχνείο, ιδιαίτερα στο κορμί μας, τον καθηγητή Ρόλφ Πίτερ Φόγελ, καθηγητή στο Πανεπιστήμιο του Αμβούργου και γενικού διευθυντή του ΣΕΡ, όπου το ακρονίμιο ΣΕΡ σημαίνει Ευρωπαϊκό Κέντρο Πυρηνικών Ερευνών. Ουσιαστικά είναι έρευνα που έχει στοιχειώδη σωματίδια και πολυτεχνείο. Η επιστημονική και διοικητική συνεισφορά του καθηγητή Ρόλφ Πίτερ Φόγελ έχει και είχε μία σημαντική επίδραση στην επιστήμη των στοιχειωδών σωματιδίων και κοσμολογία. Ο καθηγητή Ρόλφ Πίτερ Φόγελ ανέλαβε τα καθήκοντα γενικού διευθυντή στο ΣΕΡ του 2009 και αποτελεί έναν από του μακροβιότερου επικεφαλεί στην ιστορία του διεθνού αυτού οργανισμού. Ενώ από το 2004 έως το 2008 ήταν ο επιστημονικός διευθυντής του εργαστηρίου τέσης του Αμβούργου για τη σωματιδιακή και αστροσωματιδιακή. Έχει τιμηθεί με πολλά βραβεία, όπως το βραβείο Έξω Πόρτα το 2012, το Miss World Medal το 2013 και πολλές άλλες τιμητικές διακρίσεις από πολλά πανεπιστήμια διεθνώς. Φυσικά, η μεγαλύτερη διάκριση είναι η διεθνής αναγνώριση για την επιστημονική και διοικητική του συνεισφορά στην αποτελεσματική και σωστή λειτουργία του ΣΕΡ και ιδιαίτερα το μεγάλο αποτεχητή Αδρανίων που οδήγησε στην ανακάλυψη του βαθμού σωματιδίου μέσω της αλληλεπίδρασης με τα άλλα στοιχειώδη σωματίδια δίνει μάζα σε όλα τα στοιχειώδη σωματίδια. Το σωματίδιο Higgs, όπως έχουμε συνηθίσει να λέμε και όπως θυμάστε πριν μερικούς μήνες, 5 ή 6 μήνες, είχαμε εδώ στον ίδιο χώρο τον καθηγητή Φρανσουά Αντουβέρ, ο οποίος τον τιμήσαμε με κλίση και ο οποίος ήταν ένας από τους τρεις που συμμετείχαν στην πρόταση για τον μηχανισμό που δίνει μάζα στο ποιος επιτήρια και ένας από τους δύο που πήραν το κοινά του καλοφέρνηση το 2010. Στοιχεία του βιβλιαστικού του θυμόμενου θα αναφέρουμε στην άλλη συνέχεια, στην άλλη συνέχεια. Εγώ θέλω να τονίσω ότι το σχολείο μας αποφάσισε ομόφωνα την αναγόρευση του καθηγητή Ρόλφ Πίτερ Φόγελ σε επίτιμο διδάκτορα στα πλαίσια του εργασμού για τα 15 χρόνια της φυλίας της. Τελειώνοντας, θέλω να πω για την ομιλία του θυμόμενου χτες στους φοιτητές του Ιδρύματος με μεγάλη επιτυχία σε ένα αμφιθέατρο γεμάτο από νέους ανθρώπους με ζωντάνια και πολλές ευκαιρίες. Σας ευχαριστώ. Μας τιμά την παρουσία σας. Διάφορο special welcome to our university.
Dear Rector, dear Senators, colleagues and friends, after a long period of financial crisis and political turmoil, it's about time we felt the first breath of enthusiasm, as today we celebrate the visit and honorary doctorate award to Professor Rolf Dieter Hoyer, Director General of CERN. So your visit, Professor, comes indeed at a very opportune moment. Your position as Director General of the largest European not only European research facility, reminds us all that it is basic research which triggers state-of-the-art applied research. And through them both, everyday life dramatically changes, societies change, and cultures change as well. Moreover, in order to achieve its goals for innovation, CERN harmonically combines bright physicists from many disciplines with talented engineers and technicians. And the National Technical University of Athens is unique in this aspect and is rightly regarded as the most prestigious establishment of higher education in Greece, exactly because it provides the training for young people suitable for such positions. The School of Applied Science and Mathematics, which exactly along these principles, along these ideas. And your visit, Professor Hoyer, is the epitome of what the school strives for, the pursuit of excellence, both in research and education, combining basic and applied research. But there's something more to point out. I think we should reclaim our collective optimism, as this dark period is finally coming to an end. And through hard work and continuous efforts, there can be a brighter future in science and in life, especially for our new generation of scientists. This is evident for those who observed the huge young crowd in our amphitheater last evening. For me personally, all this is indeed a dream coming true, because I always believed that all these young, excited faces, eager to learn more, eager to advance, deserve the best of our own joint efforts. For if there is one thing more gratifying than the pursuit of new knowledge, it is indeed the transfer of this knowledge to young minds. So, Professor Hoyer, I would like to thank you for visiting our country. We are all very pleased and honored that you have accepted to become an honorary member of our school. But above all, I would like to thank you on behalf of our students for your broad, detailed, and inspiring presentation last evening, which I'm pretty certain they will remember for a long time. So, Herr Professor, willkommen in Griechenland, und wir sind sehr glücklich, dass Sie mit uns und für uns hier sind.
Dear Rector, Professor Hoyer, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, some technical problems also, as usual. It's not easy to present the work by Professor Hoyer in some minutes, but I will try to do my best. For sure, I have written this phrase before the yesterday talk presentation by Professor Hoyer to the students. It is, as Professor Hoyer said, Professor Hoyer inspires the next generation of scientists and engineers. Professor Hoyer, welcome to the National Technical University of Athens. Welcome to the School of Applied Mathematical and Physical Society. It is a great honor for our university and our school to have you among the distinguished academic members. And also it's a great honor to be for your scientific career and your directorship to the largest in the world particle physics laboratory, the CERN. What is the CERN? Just one slide. CERN is a laboratory founded 61 years ago by 12 European countries, among them Greece, for developing the science of peace. Today there are 21 member states, you can see below, and there are other states in accession for memberships, Romania, Serbia, associated member states, Pakistan and Turkey. I will come back about non-European countries involved in CERN business. This is one of the achievements by Professor Hoyer. And so on, plus observers, etc. The personnel in this organization has 2,300 staff Professor Hoyer was born in Germany. He studied physics in Stuttgart. He obtained his PhD in the University of Heidelberg. The first experiment he joined was the experiment J, Desi, between these years, 1975-1983, where there was an accelerator, PETRA, which is an accelerator of colliding beams, electrons and positrons, at the energy 20 to 38 instead of us. Some of the achievements of this experiment, this is the apparatus, and you can see the size of the resistor with the apparatus, you will compare later on, is the discovery of the gluon. Gluon is the force carrier of the strong interaction. And for the first time was experimental evidence with these three jets of particles, the discovery of that. And this was an experimental confirmation for the quantum chromodynamics. Next of the professor was the open collaboration at CERN for the 4 years 1984-1988 with the accelerator LEP, electron positron again beams colliding with much higher energy. There he was coordinator of a special target for the tracks of the partner introduced. You can see the calorimeter, the magnetic calorimeter, and the size of the human beings. Then you can understand the higher, much larger apparatus that we can use there. Also, he was rank coordinator of all the lab experiments for 4 years. And finally, he was the spokesperson, the person that spoke on behalf of the 300 researchers to the committees, to the conferences, etc. Then Professor Hoyer appointed a professor at the University of Hamburg and a little bit later the research director of this DESI laboratory, where he achieved many things from this laboratory. One of them was that the central, this was concentrated, the lab, the central part of his accelerator in Fermilab in USA. But some months later, on the 3rd of March 2010, it was achieved a center of mass energy of 70 TeV. It was a great moment for the physicists, and Professor Fourier declared it's a great day to be a particle physicist. A lot of people have waited a long time for this moment, but their patience and dedication is starting to pay dividends. And now we're arriving to 2012, July 4th, where both experiments, ATLAS and CMS, they are announcing their observation of a particle consistent with the Higgs boson at 125 GeV. This particle was predicted 50 years ago in theory, and many experimental efforts to discover this one were failed. Next year, 2013, October, François Eclair and Peter Higgs received the Physics Nobel Prize. The Nobel Foundation, even though when they announced the two Nobel physicists, two Nobel laureates, they have written the following statement: for the theoretical discovery of the mechanism that contributes to our understanding of the origin of mass subatomic particles, and which recently was confirmed through the discovery of the predicted fundamental particle by the ATLAS and CMS experiments at CERN's Large Hadron Collider. So it's a full recognition of the CERN's mission to this discovery. Even though later on, the same year, the famous journal Nature characterizes Professor Fourier as the Higgs diplomat. It explains that as a head of the CERN laboratory, he ensured that the world should hear about the discovery of the long-sought particle. The journal says that high-energy physicists were reluctant make such a declaration until the sentences of the statistical error are whittled down to a level known as 5 sigma, as we say. Sigma is the standard deviation for the statistics, and equals to 1 part over 3.5 million. A later experiment was right there with the Higgs data in order to announce. Professor Fourier had a reputation for guiding without being forced, without pushing, and for listening to his colleagues. In German, it is called ein Händchen. That means a gentle hand. And he also says you have to have a feeling for your people, a feeling of what they can do, of what they cannot do. It is worthwhile to remember some details of this famous announcement on 4th July 2012 at the CERN Historical Amphitheater about the Higgs boson, where after the talks by ATLAS and CMS presenting the experimental evidence of the Higgs boson, Professor Fourier, who had played the role of jovial master of the ceremony for the entire affair, stood before the packed auditorium. Now it was the time for him to drop the deep word. But Professor Fourier paused ahead of his prepared remarks. Even as a diplomat, his first words were not a declaration or a discovery, but a question to the auditorium. As a layman, I would now say, I think we have it. Do you agree? In parallel with all of these things, and after the great world's success of the Higgs boson discovery, Professor Fourier and his colleagues have initiated the design and construction projects for the future of CERN. The LHC round 2, after 2 years, 2013-2014, long shutdown and upgrade. Now the new energy is 13 TeV, 2015, currently the accelerator is working. Energy, and we have new beam batches intensity of the meeting will be accelerated, and a very far future program, the future secret and online, even though with some less priority, there are also other projects which are understandable. You can see a timeline where we stand now, and the projects that they are going, the FCC is over there again, but we have to study for now. For example, established the Transfer Technology Network, the HEPTEC, on 2009. The Scientific and Geographical Extension of CERN on 2011, where we can see countries involved as member states like Israel, non-European, but CERN, and associate members like Pakistan and Turkey. Also under negotiation, Cyprus, Ukraine, India, and Brazil. The United Nations and CERN made a great celebration for science or peace and development of CERN's 6th anniversary last year. United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon has declared last year for this opportunity, as we pursue this hugely important efforts, we can be inspired by the work done by CERN. The world faces multiple crises, but this is also an era of opportunity where great achievements are possible thanks to the science, technology, and innovation. CERN, in addition to all of them, supports the arts and the activities for young people. We have the Art at CERN program started in 2011 with three stands where artists can be hosted at CERN for a couple of months or for some days, selected by certain applications. And also the TEDx program also was worked at CERN and many other places, of course, where ideas were spreading around with different subjects for 2015. Last but not least, CERN, for the first time, proposed a kind of competition between the high school students. The Beamline for Schools competition. So invited high school students from all over the world, independent of the member states, to propose a research project, and the women will realize that experimentally. The first year, 2014, a Greek school was among the two winners, Parvaitis High School, and Dominicius College from the Netherlands, having been winners of 292 teams. Here you can see the Greek school. Here is, yes, here is the area where they did their experiment, and Professor Volker is over there. Next year we had the winners from Italy and South Africa. But in addition to all of them, Professor Hoyer made a lot of efforts to help the Greek scientists, the Greek institutions, even the Greek public. So CERN was exposed to the booth in the International Fair at Thessaloniki last year. Even the Greek Prime Minister paid a visit to Professor Hoyer and to the CERN exposition during the inauguration day of 79th Thessaloniki International Fair. Moreover, the management by Professor Hoyer education centers for kids in order to transfer technologies, set technologies, to the member states. Greece is one of the privileged six countries having established the business incubation center. On last year, 1st December, was signed the agreement, as you saw in the picture, and last June was the inauguration of this center in the Acropolis, Thessaloniki. Additionally, a new grid node was established at the Eastern Macedonia Institute of Technology in Kavala. And you see the agreement of the president of the institute and the site research director, Professor Topology, behind this professor for you. This agreement was signed on June 2013, and last year, almost 2 years later, we had the inauguration ceremony in the Green Lab, as it says in the front. This computer grid node is directly with this area. Apart from all of this, there are many other things that should be emphasized and supported. And one of them is the life sciences and physics. So it was established an international conference, Physics of Health, from 2012 to this June. Next year is planned. Also, it was established an office for transfer of cell technologies for medical applications last year. Delay is low energy iron ring, an accelerator, but it's used for physics only 1 month per year when the LHC is in operation with heavy ions. So the other, the rest of the 10-12 months, 10-11 months, biological experience. The Central European Project for the Cancer, as you see, will have beams to handle therapy for the therapy of treatment of cancer, particle detectors to help the imaging and the early diagnosis of the cancer, and a grid computer to store all these images. This kind of technology could be transferred. When Professor Hoyer visited the University Hospital of Larissa at the University of Thessaly last September, not this September, 2013, providing scientific and technical support for the construction of the Hadron Therapy Facility for the Cancer, you see the local journal about and the technical report ready to be delivered to the authorities. Famous service schools have been operated in the last 5 years. The CERN Accelerator School in Chios Island in the University of Chile, September 2011, and the CERN School of Computing in Kavala, September 2015. Professor Hoyer never stops to help Greece. Even yesterday, signed an agreement, cooperation agreement with the University of Piraeus. And in the afternoon, he gave a talk, one more talk, to the NTUA students and other students with the title High Energy Physics at CERN, Present and Future. And you can see how many people. How many students were in the field. As I said, I can talk for Professor Hoyer's work for a long time, but I think it's better to stop and just say a few words for himself. Professor Hoyer is a pleasure for me to work with him, giving the attitude, his charming smile. He has proved that managing the world's largest organization in basic research, there are needed skills for an extra broad mind, spirit for global cooperation. has opened many various and important opportunities for the development of CERN into many extra dimensions and related to the expression of the physics, which have helped to the modernization of the CERN organization. I thank all of you, Professor Kolleger, for this huge effort managing the CERN organization and for his support to the small member states and all of them Greece, for his excellent and supportive cooperation with the Greek colleagues from all institutions and from the country, for his vision to disseminate the quantum physics plus the technological and innovative results at CERN everywhere in the world without exception, for his cultural experience developed among the participants. I wish to Professor Kolleger and his family health, peace and happiness, and a special wish to keep his passion, patience and effort to continue his endless success career path. Thank you very much.
Ο Μέτρος της Σχολής θα διαβάσει την απόδοση. Εθνικό Μετσόβιο Πολυτεχνείο.
επειδή των εφημερωμένων μαθηματικών και φυσικών επιστημών σχολή, του Εθνικού Ισοβίου Πολυτεχνείου, Prof. Peter Boyer, καθηγητή του Εναμβούργου Πανεπιστημίου και Γενικού Διευθυντή του εν γενεύει Διεθνούς Οργανισμού ΣΕΡΝ, του Ιουνιβερσιτά Χάμπουργκ, του Ισένου Τζενερά, επίτιμο διδάκτορα, απευθύνατο, το Δε Βρετάνη Τάφτα έδωξαν, εγώ Κωνσταντίνο Κολάου Φαράκο, καθηγητή και κοσμήτων τη των εφημερωμένων μαθηματικών και φυσικών επιστημών σχολή, εμένου, είστε του Πανεπιστημίου Νόμης και της Ημετέρας Σχολής Δόγμαση, ρώθητε πόγια και στους επιτήμους της Σχολής Διδάκτρας Αναγορεύου και πάστα της Προνομίας, τα το δέτο αξιώματι παρεκόμενα από νέο αυτό. Εγένετο, Αθήνηση, μηνός Οκτωβρίου, 3η και 10η, έτη 5η και 10η και δυσκολοστό από τους γενείς μας, ότι στον εφημοσμένο μαθηματικών και φυσικών επιστημών σχολής, το Βρίτο Κωνσταντίνος.
Πρέπει να έρθει και ο αντιδοτής Ρίτανης και ο ετοιμόμενος.
First of all, it's a great honor, a great pleasure for me to be here, but it's in particular a great honor to receive this honorary degree here at the National Technical University Conference. Thank you very much for all of this, and thank you very much for all this collaboration over the many, many years with CERN. And that brings me to my first point. Whatever was discussed here and described by Professor Cassis is not the work of a single person. It's a team. Teamwork of many, many thousands of people in order to achieve all this. And now we can do anything. We need a tremendous amount of colleagues, friends, hard workers, and also less hard workers in order to achieve it. So this is the greatest thing. And CERN is a fantastic place because, as you see from the mission here, it unites people, it unites countries, it unites cultures. We speak one language, and that language is science. When you speak one language, you can achieve something. That's fantastic. And I'm very happy that I could lead that organization for 7 years now, or nearly 7 years. I still have 2 months and 17 days to go. I will not give you now a scientific lecture, but I cannot assist go back to the 4th of July 2014, because scientifically this was a fantastic day. It was a discovery of this boson, the scalar boson, which is commonly called the Higgs boson, representing the Paul-Klee Higgs field. And it made headlines and interest everywhere.
some of you might ask yourself, why is that of interest for me? Well, you are better interested in that, because it is the basis of your existence. Because this particle, or the field which it represents, gives mass to the fundamental particles out of which our visible universe, out of which you and I are composed of, it gives mass to all of these fundamental particles. And this mass, be it tiny or large, is fundamental in order to form composite matter. Without having mass to the fundamental particles, there could be no composite matter, and we would just physically not exist. So I think it's very, very important to find, to have formed this particle, because it really gives us now an idea why we physically can exist. It took us 50 years, roughly, as I said already, to complete our description of the visible universe. But that's only 5%, roughly 5% of the universe. 95% of the universe are dark, the dark universe. Around one quarter of it is dark matter. Three quarters of it is dark energy. Dark matter is clumping like normal matter, it is gravitation. Dark energy is driving the universe apart in an accelerated way. We don't know what dark matter is. Maybe it consists out of particles, special particles. But we don't know. We have no clue what dark energy is. So, I repeat again, it took us 50 years to describe what is a universe. Isn't it high time now to enter the dark universe? And why should we enter the dark universe? Let's quote Aristoteles. Nature does nothing uselessly. So I think we have to explore why nature has introduced dark matter, why nature has introduced dark energy. And the Higgs particle, the Higgs boson, could be maybe the portal to this dark universe. Because if it is giving mass to the visible, to the particles of the visible world, it could also give mass to the particles which could also be formed dark matter. It could also give possibly hints to dark energy. So it could really be the portal to try to start understanding dark matter, to start maybe understanding dark energy. So that's exciting science. That is fascinating science. But very often I hear that this is only basic science. But what about the economic value of it? Well, this is an everlasting question. And already Michael Faraday, he was living in essentially in the first half of the 19th century, that means around 200 years ago, he studied electromagnetism. And already at that time, he was visited by his finance minister, who came to his laboratory and told him, "Mr. Faraday, great what you are doing here, but what can it be used for?" Already 200 years ago, that question was asked. And I think Michael Faraday gave, to my mind, the best answer. He said to his finance minister, "Honestly, sir, I don't know it. But maybe one day you can tax it." Okay? I think that's the best answer. Because we don't know where we can use the results. But we know we can use them at some stage. We don't know where, and we don't know when. Sometimes it takes a long time. But there's more to it. There's really a virtuous circle. I think you expressed it very well. Basic science drives applied science. Applied science drives innovative technologies. And these innovative technologies drive away basic science. So it's a virtuous circle. And this virtuous circle should not be broken. It is really important to keep this virtuous circle all the time alive. It's very, very important also for the sustainable future of this planet and of mankind. So electricity is a very good example. But there's another good example out of our direct field. That is antimatter. Antimatter was postulated in 1928. It was a fantastic
dynamics of the electrons. The problem was, in this equation, the mass of the electron appeared in the square. Now, everybody should remember from the school that if something is squared, you can have a positive solution of it, whether squared or negative one. Now, the positive one was clear, that's the electron. What about the negative one? Now, Dirac wrote this equation. He was brave enough to postulate, okay, that's the antiparticle to the electron, the positive, antimatter. It took only 3 years or 4 years to discover the positron, so that it was rather short compared to the discovery of the H-proton after the postulation. But the point is, that was pure basic science. And today they are using it in the hospital. Since around 40 years, antimatter is used in the hospital. It's used in the positron emission tomography, PET scan. The P, the positron, is the antiparticle, the electron. So we are using it in the hospital. But to use that in the hospital is not enough. Yeah. The positron makes a certain reaction in the body. And you have to recognize this reaction. So, and for this, you need innovative technologies. So you have to recognize the signal which comes out from the positron annihilation in the body. And today, we are using for this imaging detector pieces which were developed for the large atom collider experiments, one of the experiments, and the electronics developed for that. So again, a direct spin-off here from the research itself, but also from innovative technologies. But again, this is not enough. We need more technologies, to develop more innovative technologies. And from our field, one of the nice examples are the developments of the accelerators. Because you can use today accelerators in order to treat cancer. We have already heard that also. If we can use cancer, we can use the accelerators to treat the cancer in a much more efficient way than with X-rays. This is in particular very important for young children who have cancer, because the treatment with ions out of the accelerators, be it protons or heavy ions or light ions, so they can treat the cancer in a much more pointed way than the X-rays. So they affect the healthy tissue much, much less than X-rays. And that is very important for the growth of the children afterwards. But again, this is not enough. We need also computing. We need a lot of computing power in order to store data, to analyze data, also for the medical sector. The more statistics you have, the better you can treat patients, the better you can do personalize medical applications. And in computing, again, servers at the forefront, and still is at the forefront. Don't forget that the web was born, it's now 26 years ago, at CERN. But it was born because we were driven by the needs of our research. And this is why we have developed the World Wide Web. And I think it has changed the world. It has changed the world of our behavior. And it has changed the world of economics. So you can make up your mind if it was to the good or to the bad. It was really a big change. So these examples clearly show the intimate connection between basic science, applied science, innovative technologies. I think this is a fantastic example of the virtuous circle. And this is something which we need to continue. We need to continue for a sustainable future. But again, it's not enough. We need scientists and engineers to perform the work and to develop things further. And we need science-educated people to support it. So we need to engage society with science. We need to engage society for science. Society has to realize that research and science is the future. It was in the past the future for today. It is today the future for tomorrow. I think we need to fascinate, we need to capture the imagination of young people. We need to trigger their interest in science. I mean, the young people yesterday in the auditorium was all fantastic. It was a very nice crowd. There are many more who don't make it to this. I think we need more of these which are so this. So how can we do that? Well, first of all, kid, when I give outreach talks, public lectures, the young people are always, even if they are not yet students, they are always very, very excited about that. The best example is a young guy, a pupil from in London, when I gave an outreach talk in London. He came afterwards and said, I want to study physics, and I want to work later at CERN. So, in roughly 5 years, I know that I can go to CERN. Then we had the discovery of the explosion. So the talk was before the discovery. So after the discovery, he wrote to me an email. He congratulated us to this discovery. But then came the sentence, please don't discover more before I get to search. Isn't that dedication? Isn't that great? Is that not worthwhile to give such talks? That's fantastic. I like it very much. So, we need to transport this interest, which many, many young people show, also into schools. And this is why we have teachers' workshops, in order to re-motivate teachers. We have we nearly had 600 teachers from Greece already visiting us for these workshops. Why do we need the teachers here? Because I think we have to address these questions in schools first, and not the old mechanics or whatever. We have to start addressing these main questions, these big questions. Because then the pupils, they know for what they have to learn the basics. They know what they can address with it. And you can, I think you can describe things in logic in such a way that they understand, okay, now I want to address this question, but then I need to go back to some of the basics. Maybe that's naive, but when I discuss with teachers, they always have this. Let's turn around the curriculum and let's start with the big questions, interest the people, then you tell them, okay, now you have to learn the basics. Okay? So, let's keep in mind, again, let's close with this, once more with Aristoteles. He said, the roots of education are bitter, but the fruit is sweet.
Thank you.
Αύριο στη σχόλα σήμερα λέει, το πέρασε με 4 ευρώ Ελλάδα.